I got my master's at the University of Harvard.
Okay, everyone, thank you so much for coming. This is the fourth public school talk and the first in-person talk, so I'm super excited. I want to thank Class Division for hosting and Victoria, my collaborator with homeschool. It's really possible. Today's talk is by Demian and DinéYazhi. DinéYazhi. And he's a Portland-based transdisciplinary warrior, born to the Bitterwater and Water's Edge clans of the Dene tribe. He received his BFA in Intermediate Arts from PNCA in 2014. And I have a whole bunch of text. Are you
good? No.
Yeah. Everyone knows him. He's famous. He's amazing. His work is interdisciplinary, intergenerational. It's incredible. He is currently doing a show at the Portland Art Museum Center for Contemporary Art called DinéYazhi. It's a duo show with Demian and Kaylee Spitzer. It's open until August 28th, I think. You should go check it out. And you're doing an artist talk on June 11th there as well, too, right?
Yes, yeah.
And is that free? Or?
I think it might be. I think it's free.
Cool.
I don't know.
It'll be
fun. I'll be talking about some of that work here, so you can go.
Cool.
Yeah.
And it's June 11th, 2 to 3 p.m. So, without further ado, thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you, Manuel and Victoria and the Compliance Division for hosting. I'll start off by reading a poem. Actually, I just got back from doing this, maybe it was like a 10 or 11 city tour. It was a poetry tour called Soul Nostalgia. I did it with this artist, Jess X Chen. I went from like LA, like through the Southwest, New Mexico, like Norman, Oklahoma, St. Louis, Chicago, Pittsburgh, Peekskill, like North, like which is a part of like upstate New York, and then we ended it in. So that was a really exciting like adventure. It definitely like opened my world up to like the poetry and like the potential that it has in different communities, and just the way that people came out and showed support was like really awesome. But also being able to like speak about Indigenous issues was really rad. Like, because I know in some of these places it's just not brought up. Even the fact that, even when you just mentioned that like we're on Indigenous stolen and occupied land, when we were in like north, like in upstate New York at Peekskill, like there was this like group of like white liberal women who kind of like helped organize that event, and it was really rad because it was a bunch of like female curators who like are running that space. But they're, you know, they're very well-meaning and just kind of latching on to anything that they could to sort of relate to what it means to be Indigenous, like from their own perspective. But it was very stereotypical and a little racist. Like she came up and was like, she's like, oh, I've always had more of a connection to like being Indigenous. Like I always felt like I felt more connected to that than my own culture and like, my spirit animal came to me in Central Park, and so don't make that mistake. I don't have a spirit animal. If I did, it would probably be Paula Cole. And the way some of y'all reacted when I played that song really hurt my feelings.
Wait, what was your reaction?
He was like, oh, Paula Cole. And I was like, there's more to Paula Cole than like Dawson's Creek and unshaven armpits and Lilith Fair. Anyway, okay, I'm gonna read a poem from this book. So the tour we were on was called Soul Nostalgia, and we were using this word, which means like the pain that one experiences when their homeland or like place that they love is under attack or an immediate threat. And so the way I came to sort of embrace that word during the tour was sort of around this idea of like how Western media or Western romanticized narratives of like sci-fi generally tend to romanticize this idea of like a dystopian post-apocalyptic future. But like for indigenous communities, like we're like constantly navigating spaces that are like this post-apocalyptic dystopian reality. So that was one way that I came in to like embrace this word and really just sort of like figure out how I, like what poems like best related to the topic. I'll read a shorter one just because I'll talk a lot, but so this one is about growing up in Gallup, New Mexico, and which is like just right outside of like the Navajo Reservation. And I grew up in a household with like, you know, my parents are still together, but my father like worked a swing shift, so like he wasn't always around, but my mother sort of raised this entire household full of like four older women and myself. So I always felt that my identity was always influenced by like this sort of this matriarchal figure, like teaching other women how to grow up like in traditional ways, but also like growing up in like outside of the reservation, influenced by like 80s and like 90s pop culture. So this memory is also about, or like about memory and trying to remember like back to my first memory, but also realizing that like my first memory is like tied to like ancestral trauma. And so science says that nowadays we can basically, there are basically studies that say that past ancestral traumatic events like get passed through your DNA. But like for indigenous peoples, I don't think we ever needed science to tell us that. Like it's written into our ceremony, our traditions and creation stories. So this is honoring that. And it's called Antelope on the Canyon Walls. I grew up in a household with five older women and my father. And being the only boy, I always had a room of my own. When I was four, we moved away from the reservation. Sometimes I think my first memory must have been riding in my father's truck as we drove away from my grandparents' house. A trailer resting beside a hogan planted firmly to the floor of an ocean in Chinle Valley, flowing out like water from a windmill. Mostly, I imagine my first memory was in the embryo. As my parents listened to Stevie Nicks and Jackson Brown as they drove to the Indian capital of the world, with my sisters sitting in the back seat, and as we crossed the threshold of the Navajo Nation and entered the United States of America, I remembered all my ancestors who traversed this land from first light to eventide, or from the first encounter with the Biligana to the relatives they parted ways with in Northern California. It was during a prayer at my grandparents' hogan, at the moment when everyone was talking together and joking around in a dated version of DinéYazhi that slowly disappears with the passing of our elders. And in my dreaming through that mist of tribal memory, I run my fingers along the interior of my mother's womb like my ancestors, drawing antelope on the canyon walls. And in that wet, embryonic state, I remember the suspicious and seductive introduction of the English language. And then another memory strikes me behind my head, across my ass, against the back of my hand, knocks my field of vision into an abstract clutter of treachery. And I hear gunfire and screaming and church songs and a stampede of horses running from a cornfield ablaze. And I notice bloody sheep wool from sheep we won't eat. And in my dreaming through that labyrinth of ancestral memory, I remember the sun and the formation of the stars and constellations before my gender became a compass, before my gender became a scar or a performance or a privilege or clouded in mystery or Catholic shame. I remember floating in a sea of long black hair, weightless above the cradle of civilization, before my sexuality became oppressive, before my sexuality became life-threatening or a slur or a jail cell or a virus or a wound against my head, as blood drained into cracks of dry earth in some earthen canyon, while I was running for my life, running against the wind, running up that hill, running on empty, while I ran so far away, because baby, we were born to run, baby, run to the hills, run for your lives. And somewhere in my DNA, there is a Zuni woman, and a Nakai man, and a Biligana man, and they're all worried about disease, so they make us wash our hands, only to wash their hands after they touch our skin. And my entire life has been one epidemic to the next, from smallpox to influenza to diabetes to tumors to the hantavirus to HIV and AIDS to genocide to capitalism and the next wave of environmental meltdown. The first memory is always a collective memory tied to ancestral memory. Maybe it's the memory of breathing, the memory of walking, of laughing for the first time, or emerging from the womb of my mother and into the glittering world. Thanks.
You have that one to say, all right?
Oh, yeah, so we made zines, and Jess and I both have like 5 poems each. We like just really quickly ran these off without so there's like her acknowledgments get cut off, and so just know that she has more people to thank than like with her journals. And then there's just like weird edits, like it says ancestors and some ancestors or shit like that. But yeah, these are for sale, these are $10. And then there's some other zines on like centered around Indigenous poetry called Survivance.
Woo!
And Melissa Bennett is in a scene along with like myself and 4 other like First Nations and Indigenous poets. It's a really good zine, and it has like a new cover, which is exciting. And then there's this other zine I have, which is about the Albatross occupation and how Richard Oakes swimming to the island could be like added into the canon of like performance art, because it's kind of like happening at the same time as like Yayoi Kusama and shit. Anyway, there's those two. And I'll kind of talk about that piece a little bit more, maybe in terms of like the Indians of all tribes and the occupation of Alcatraz a little bit later. But yeah, I'm a transdisciplinary artist. I went to school at the UNCA. Was at like the old location, and so it's been really interesting, like being in the community and just seeing how like that whole place has evolved and shifted. But that experience, like I really used my time at PNCA as a way to just get a degree. Like it was a really fucking expensive degree, but it also did something for me that I could not like have done otherwise or elsewhere, I think, and that was just exposed me to like a lot of like really awesome theoretical concepts, but also just some of the teachers they have there are like really fucking amazing. So I felt like it was important for me to go there, but it also allowed me like a shit ton of access to like just like fuck around with different equipment. So if you're in school, like, you know, take advantage of that, because I really got into the letterpress, and like I don't have access to that anymore. It really sucks. But that goes into the statement, which kind of like is a reflection to a certain degree of my time at PNCA and has like influenced my art practice. Through my indoctrination into the privileged white walls of the art school industrial complex, I acknowledge the importance of critiquing mainstream contemporary art spaces. By participating in the contemporary art world, galleries and museums, I also recognize how crucial the existence of non-traditional alternative spaces are in helping to disrupt the white noise of modern art. In order to deconstruct the contemporary art movement and the fortification of Western historical narratives, decolonizing and working outside the jurisdiction of these institutions becomes a critical component of the affirmation and evolution of the art, culture, history, and lived experiences of marginalized peoples. So that like that really led me into like my time at PNCA really led me into exploring more about like queerness and my Indigenous history, or not even history, just like ancestry portions of it, just basically all the issues that like those two like the intersections of those two communities is like pretty large. That's a picture of my grandmother still gone, or my grandparents still gone. I'll briefly mention this image later. Like, this is a picture of my maternal grandparents still gone. And so, like, this is like the traditional housing of like the Diné people on the reservation. So, like a lot of my, a lot of like my family's like ceremony like has taken place in this space. And so I feel like there's just a lot of like cultural ties to it for me, like even through memory. But the evolution of the Hope Run has changed too. Like it's gone from this like earthen structure to this state, and like now they like put a drywall around it and like little porch lights, and probably like flat screen TVs inside of it. It's kind of weird. But so I like moving forward, like I kind of was interested in this idea of like radical indigenous queer feminism and like the intersections of like what is deemed radical indigenous queer or feminist. So I feel like my artwork is really pulling from these different sort of mindsets, or but I'm also interested in like trying to create like a framework or a place within like theoretical discussions to talk about this idea or ideology of radical indigenous queer feminism. Because I feel like there's a lot of artists who are like really hitting like the nail on just a number of these. And I guess the idea for this came through making these posters, which are in the background. And I made these posters through Rise, which is a an indigenous like artist collective that is centered and focused on like the evolution, perseverance, and education of indigenous art and culture. So this image is like of a woman, and it says "No Way Feminism," and this one is "Decolonize Your Love." But to get there, I had to fuck around a little bit with like my own idea of gender and how I've come into like embody like more masculine features or traits. And so I feel like I did that a lot through the music I listened to, which was like, you know, initially it was like Jewel and Paula Cole. It was whatever my sisters listened to, like the Cranberries and shit, but like eventually, like, you know, you get sick of that. So I started listening to like, you know, more alt rock during that time period. And so PJ Harvey definitely came into view. But so this video, Man Size, is about sort of like familiarizing myself with like female figures who inhabit these like androgynous or even masculine sort of personas. And so I felt like by being exposed to that, I felt like I was embracing what I deemed as acceptable masculinity, like through this lens, or even through Riot Girl, like versus like, I don't know, I could like really point out that time period would be like Billy Corgan or Kurt Cobain or Trent Reznor or something. Like there was just something always about like, this whole time period that really fascinated me. So I just created this homage video. Just reenacted Man Size. And should I play it? Like,
yeah.
Do you want to watch it? Okay.
I'm so to show.
So I guess I'm showing it. It was this. Oh yeah. Okay. So I made that video when I was at like in PNCA, and it was really weird showing it to people. Like, I'm sorry, I'm a little nervous right now. But I feel anyway. I showed it to the class, and they were like. Like, I think it was hard for, like, some white, like, straight white dudes to sort of understand. So, like, the critique there was really, really weird. And so, anyway, I feel like the time at PNC, I've been just going back to this work recently because it's been a few years, so I was kind of, like, interested in, like, and I kind of miss going to school, so I'm just going to talk about it briefly, but, yeah, I felt like, yeah, I needed to respond, or, sorry, the work that I was doing at this time was, like, sort of, like, trying to figure out where, I'm so sorry, I'm trying to figure out what I'm trying to say, and I just feel really stuck, but, yeah, I was basically just trying to figure out like how to construct like my identity like through artwork, and so it was during this time period that I really like started to focus in on like what was queer, what was like I kind of focused on like HIV and AIDS aspects to like art production, and then that eventually led like into like curating shows as a way to sort of like respond to like how. Closed off like certain networks felt at PNCA. This kind of leads. I did this installation while I was there that was focused on like creating awareness about like HIV and AIDS. And so Gabe Flores used to have this space, I believe it was called Place. And it was right next to Space, right? He had Space and Place, and they were right next to one another. So this was just sort of like installed into the windows along with like this longer text piece that was talking about like the commodification of like HIV and like HIV medications through like the Western medical industrial complex. And so it was just like in constant rotation, but there was just like a little bit of wordplay that I was throwing out there. So these appear just on like side monitors. But this led to creating like more posters that are like very text heavy that, you know, have the intention to like create an awareness about about issues like more in depth. So this was actually a letterpress poster that was like, you know, on a strip of rice paper that just like ran the length of a wall. And that whole project had to do with like gift giving. So I imagined like these posters would go to like an elementary school or some sort of like public health center, you know, that would just basically create awareness about like HIV stigma. And so this is age-related art. Awareness is knowledge, is systemic, is power, is profitable, is death, is life, is privilege, is immunity, is resistance, is survival. And so I was, you know, like in really hard ways trying to create like this relationship between like these words and the word is, but also was really interested in like DNA and the helix. I don't know if it like really goes together, but I was trying to like use the word is as a way to sort of like bind those two words together visually. And then like toward the end of my time at PNC, I did this show called Bury My Art at Wounded Knee, Blooding Guts in the Art School Industrial Complex, as a response to sort of the like sophistication and speaking about like race or gender or queerness within like the classroom or through critiques. I felt like whenever I brought up any sort of conversation that had to do with like race, particularly like Indigenous issues, those like they were always like for the most part like well addressed and spoken about like with the actual instructor, but like were completely lacking like with my classmates. Wasn't getting the feedback or response that I needed to sort of bring it up to like our inclusion specialist. His response was basically like, well, Demian, like sometimes we have to like be the ones to like bring water to the village, otherwise like we don't get water. And so I was like, well, it's always a brown person who has to bring water to the village. You know, and that's not like the job of like a student to do, like that's the job of like an institution to do. So, you know, bringing this up to him, like didn't really get anywhere. I felt like the only way that I could actually make sure that I was getting an education that touched on Indigenous issues was to like approach each instructor and sort of like make that known that that was important for me in my education. So a few instructors like, you know, would really focus on that, like Ann Johnson was really generous about that. But I felt like the only way that I could make some sort of statement was to like just curate a show and create an actual space for Indigenous art. So I chose during my thesis year to focus less on my artwork and more on like trying to create like some sort of like conversation or discussion inside of that institution. My entire time there was never a show that was like purely dedicated to Indigenous art or an Indigenous artist. So I wanted it to be as loud as possible. And I also really got into like the aesthetics of like curating the show, like the postering that goes into it, the promotional aspects of it, the show cards. I ran like 300 like limited edition letterpress show cards. All the posters were done on the letterpress, and those were limited as well. And so this piece right here is on this very far back wall at the school. It was probably, I don't know, around like 17 feet high. But it was based off of one of the posters, and it was just like hand painted one day. But the show was really awesome because it allowed that work to be on display for like 2 months. I felt like it was also a really awesome show because every single artist that I reached out to like agreed to like send their work for free. Like that was one of the stipulations in doing the show. It was like, hey, like I have this idea and this concept for a show. here's the entire package and the idea of what, like, I, you know, what I'm trying to, like, pursue with it. The, like, really shitty thing is, like, I can't afford to, like, ship you any of the work. I can't afford to pay you for the exhibition. So it felt reaffirming that, like, this, like, gradient of indigenous, like, people who have, like, this artistic skill, but also have, like, this career that's, that, you know, they're either, like, emerging or they've, like, been in the arts since, like, the 70s. We're all willing to, like, see the importance of having this type of work in this space. The inspiration for the show came from this book called Bury My Heart at Wounded Knee, which is, like, this this Native North American perspective of the history of the Native American body, you know, after colonization. And it's this book by Dee Brown, and it's really thick and hella depressing. But I was also referencing, like, the occupation of Wounded Knee and the massacre of Wounded Knee. The massacre of Wounded Knee, like, happened around the 1890s, and the occupation of Wounded Knee by an Indian movement happens in, like, 1971. So I felt like, even though I wasn't necessarily, like, a part of, like, any sort of, like, Plains tribe, I felt like those two incidents, like the massacre at Wounded Knee, which is a response to, like, a lot of paranoia of the U.S. government and the genocide of the American Indian, was, like, a loud, you know, act of warfare against indigenous tribes that, like, reverberated against around the nation. Like, you know, it, like, set a pretty strong example of, like, what happens to, like, indigenous people who, like, resist this, like, you know, master race that's coming on. And so then the same thing happens, like, in 1971 with, like, the occupation of Wounded Knee by the American Indian movement. You know, that gets really heated and, like, out of control, and the same thing happens. Leonard Peltier, like, you know, goes to jail for shooting an FBI agent. Whether or not he actually did, like, I think the point of that matter is the fact that, like, he wasn't given a fair trial. But the way that the American Indian movement, like, starts up is through the occupation of Alcatraz Island back in, like, 1969, after the San Francisco, like, Indian Center burns down. So Richard Oakes, like, decides to, like, make this, like, performative gesture where he, like, swims to the island and reclaims it for indigenous peoples. And his whole thing is, like, this, like, is, like, this whole group of more, like, educated indigenous youth who are really wanting to reclaim, like, indigenous identity and indigenous land. So it's, like, at this very critical moment, like, you know, right around the time of, like, the civil rights movement, that, you know, indigenous people just, like, strike when the iron's hot. So I was really interested in, like, artwork, like, if there was political artwork that was made during that time period, like, what would it look like? I feel like indigenous peoples, when opportunity to, like, make any sort of, like, voice, it's always, like, strike when the iron's hot. There isn't like as much time to, like, properly plan for things. And so I wonder, like, how much of, like, any form of, like, artistic expression, like, gets lost in that whole process. Like, if there was a subsection of the movement, like, purely dedicated to, like, art production, like, what would that look like? And so that's kind of what I was asking when I put out the proposal, like, where an art would be. It was, like, type of, like, political artwork out there, like, what would your response be? Like, what do you consider to be, like, a politically charged message? And then what I ended up getting were things that were completely different, that I didn't think were as political, but, you know, through, like, learning more about the artists, the process, like, the concepts behind their work, it made me, like, appreciate and realize that, like, indigenous artists are being, like, extremely political with a lot of their artwork. It's just not necessarily in the same way that I had, like, planned. This comes through paintings, through like photography that has like this intergenerational aspect to it, but also has like a lot of like caretaking of the environment and like the loss of land and language. And that means after that show, like I decided to throw, I wasn't really thinking about it, but I decided to throw like Rise, Radical Indigenous Survivance and Empowerment at the bottom. And kind of like threw up like this really quick like synopsis of what I thought the collective would be. And at this point it was a collective. Or I was thinking of it more as like this like collective experience that like every single Indigenous person was a part of. So it wasn't necessarily like one person's vision. It was just more creating like sort of like a framework for, you know, for their conversations to happen. So I was thinking of it more as an imagined like collective, like all this artwork and art production would be done this Rise, and then all of a sudden, like, you know, I would just unplug it and then like push it aside and like see what happens in like 10 years. Like I was also interested in like how things get archived, how like political ephemera or images, especially like in this like post-internet phase, like how they get memorialized like in the future. So then after that, I decided to keep going and keep making posters. And so one poster I created, the first poster I created as a part of this that was separate from the Grammar Art at Wounded Knee exhibition was this poster called No Way Feminism. And this was like made in response to just reading a lot about Indigenous feminism and wanting to sort of create like a strong image that reclaimed like Indigenous female identity, or just Indigenous identity in general. This woman, I'm having a really hard time finding this photograph on the internet lately, but it's just this very much like Edward S. Curtis photograph of this like woman. And on the front of her, you can kind of like see a little bit of like her cleavage and areola. And so I was really bothered by that, just in terms of like reading more texts about how Indigenous women are like sexually assaulted. And, you know, happens to other races within the country. And just a lot of, I was also inspired by like the Missed Men Murdered Indigenous Women campaign up in Canada, which, you know, has ties as well to like the women in Juarez like missing like back in like the early 2000s that like really exploded. So I wanted to create an image that was like calling out you know, these like different waves of feminism, like first, second, and third waves. There's a text by Andrea Smith where she states like, if one were to create a history of feminism within the United States, like it would need to reach back to like 1491 to the resistance of patriarchal colonization. And so like the women, the Iroquois women around the same time that like this, like the first waivers are like getting going are like having conversations about how like they've already had all these things that like the first wave feminists are like fighting for. And, but they, you know, it's all been like taken away like through colonization. So this was a way to sort of like pay homage to that, the like matrilineal and, like just like cultural upbringing of Indigenous communities. And so then in the background, I just like indigenized or like the American flag, like took the context and the power away from it and created like new, you know, new color tone and put it together in like this like graph or design that like disoriented the viewer, you know, that you don't immediately recognize like the American flag. So then anyway, I did a shit ton of other posters, and so the posters are like all available like on the internet for free. It's more about like creating access and awareness than it is necessarily about like entering this conversation into like this art market. But it's also about like, because it's creating access, it like gives access to potentially like a teenager on the Pine River Indian Reservation or in the middle of fucking Arizona. It allows them access to it and allows them to do whatever the hell they want with the image, like once they get it. And so one project that we did, I did with this other Navajo artist, we just went around the reservation and around Gallup, New Mexico, and just like we pasted some of these posters just around town. And that felt really good to do, like just to reclaim those spaces. But also like Gallup, New Mexico, like back in the like early 90s, like 2020 did this special on the town and like just called it Drumtown USA. So like that had like always been haunting us. About like exposure deaths, like especially later, or like indigenous like people just getting like, you know, hit by semi-trucks like trying to cross a freeway and shit. But you also hear the other side of it, which is like, you know, high incidences of alcoholism like in the hills. And I think my mom put herself into like these really like dangerous positions trying to like, you know, take care of like her father. Her older brother. So it felt like this message needed to be in that space because like the way that heteropatriarchy like works in reservation, like it's not just like a non-native thing, it's also happening like with the native communities. So it's like important to address and like figure out ways to like dismantle the way like patriarchy works in these communities. And so these are just other interpretations of it that are like slightly hitting this like indigenous feminism sort of vibe, indigenous futurisms. And they're just like recontextualizing like the American, or just different, you know, that's like the Southern flag. And so then that leads to creating posters that are centered around like indigenous queer cultures. I don't identify as a two-spirit, but like there's also like two-spirit cultures. Like the word two-spirit gets like made up like in the early 90s at a conference in like the Bay Area. And it's just basically respecting and honoring like different types of indigenous sexualities and gradings of gender. And so I'm always interested in like having one foot in and one foot like outside of the reservation. And so this poster, Decolonize Your Love, was sort of a way to do that. It's focusing on like two indigenous queer and gender gradient individuals. But in the background, an inverted like Photoshop image is an image, like a wallpaper image of this photograph, which is of Marsha P. Johnson and Sylvia Rivera. And they're like marching on Christopher Street. They have this organization in New York City called STAR. And so they were really like dedicated to creating a space for like the trans community. A community that like is still like fighting for space and representation. And so, you know, I feel like that has ties to like indigenous cultures and indigenous peoples as well. Like, I was recently having this conversation with someone and they were basically saying that like, there's potential proof that like indigenous, queer or gender gradient individuals were like the first people who were like assaulted and like singled out like during colonization and like genocide. So like really interested me because it's, you know, it's still like very active and prevalent today. And so then this image kind of leads to these two other images, which are, it's like these two Natli, gender gradient, like queers from the Navajo Reservation. And this photograph was taken during the Bosque Redondo days, which is like the forced removal of the Navajo to Fort Sumner. So back in like the 1860s, the Navajo were like forced to leave. We were forced to leave our homelands and make this like 300-mile journey on foot, and oftentimes by gunpoint, all the way to this like to the clear other side of New Mexico, which has like a completely different terrain and landscape. And you know, after 2 years, it basically fails. Like it was an experimental like internment camp for indigenous peoples. And so, you know, the crops like fail. It's just shitty. Like there was 500 Mescalero Apaches who were in that region, and like they all escaped. And so then after this whole time period, the United States is like, oh, just kidding. Like you can go back to your homeland. Like we'll write a new treaty. You can go back. But they're forced to like walk back, like the entire journey back. But anyway, separate from that, like that's just that. So this photograph is like taken like during their time, like at Gualdi, at Bosque Redondo. And so I wanted to recontextualize it as a way to like remind the viewer that like indigenous, queer, and gender gradient people existed like prior to colonization, prior to like the 1970s or the AIDS crisis or gay marriage, as a way to also like call out like this like radical queer community that just like doesn't oftentimes like take into account indigenous people or indigenous sexualities. And so that leads me into like creating more of this recent work. And this is just an image that's been fucked with in Photoshop of like the first Thanksgiving. And it's like merging this idea of like the genocide of indigenous people to like the genocide of the queer community like back in the 90s. And this is a further sort of investigation or inquiry into that as well. And it, like the way I've been thinking about like Photoshop lately is like I never learned like my traditional artwork. Like I don't know how to weave. I don't know how to like. I'm not a silversmith, or I don't, you know, make like weave baskets or anything. But I've been thinking about like Photoshop as like a contemporary mode of weaving, like creating different layers and just piecing everything together. And so this was one of like the more sort of complex images I was trying to like put together and assemble. On this, the far left image, it's just a GIF, but like, it's of like, two young Navajo co-talkers. My grandfather was a co-talker. He was like, basically just taken out of this classroom and like forced to join the military. And my mother's last name used to be Draper, and it got changed to Guy when they were enlisting him. Like the woman was just like, oh, those two guys over there. And so the woman just wrote down like Guy. And so that like completely changed like their whole last name. And then there's this other woman who's like, you know, being photographed by like probably an Anglo photographer, but she's not even looking at the camera. And so that always sort of haunted me. And then this middle image is like the HIV virus. These two images are of also the AIDS virus. But there's like, they're in rotation like with an image of like the Mayflower. And then you just have this like badass Navajo woman like holding down her land and shit with like a rifle. Like just some traditional gear and shit. And then on the very far right, we have like these whirling logs just in constant rotation. And this is like the whirling logs have like very traditional healing purposes behind it, but it, you know, like through like Nazi shit, like it just gets complex. So this is also sort of like a way to like reclaim that image for indigenous peoples, like however complex that is, like post World War, or post Holocaust. And that, so yeah, this kind of like leads into like this exhibition that I'm a part of. And this is an image that I created. It's like, it's 39 inches by 39 inches and it's wheat pasted. It's using bluebird flour, which is like made in like huge quantities in the Four Corners area. It's like a staple household item on the reservation. It has like this really beautiful image of like a bluebird like on a tree, I believe, or something like that. But it usually will get like made into like quilts or like skirts that like grandmas wear. Like it's just repurposed. Yeah, that, like the blue part of the image, the sign like that is all like just blue birds stacked on each other. All these photographs were taken at the Bashes, which is like this like supermarket store that's available on reservation. They don't have kombucha, but they do have bluebird flour. And like, so it's amazing going in there because it's all this like modified food in like stacks. So there's just like a shit ton of bluebird flour. There's a shit ton of like Clabber Girl baking powder and like the Morrill lard. And you know, there's like a shit ton of spam there too. Like just shit that, you know, has like been co-opted by indigenous peoples as a way to survive. And it's also gotten mixed into like what is like traditional food, and it's all really bad for you. But these ingredients also were like given to like indigenous peoples during like the long walk and, you know, the Bosque Redondo camp days. And so that's sort of like when like fire bread becomes like such a staple of Navajo culture. So I was thinking about that and like how identity and like culture gets like erased, but also how indigenous people like adapt to their situations and reclaim it to a certain degree. And so around this time, I was also driving around and I was shooting this video called Indigenous Love. And I had to like use, it was like based around the Hinkey Code. And so within the Hinkey Code, like there's no, like you can cruise for someone and you can cruise and signal. Does everyone know what the Hinkey Code is? No? Okay. So the Hinkey Code was like a way for queers to like signal. It was like a way to signal for what sort of like sexual activities they were looking for. You know, so like before Grindr or Adam for Adam or Tinder. But you know, you would either put like a different color hanky like in the back of your pockets to symbolize like whether you were like the dominant or submissive person in that role, but also different colors meant different things. So like if you wanted to get fucked or fisted or dress up as a furry or something, you know, like there's different signals within it. And so within that, like there's also ones like if you're looking for a white dude or a Latino dude or a black dude or an Asian dude, but there was none that was like for anyone who was Middle Eastern or Native. I was really interested in trying to like just think of a hanky that'd be appropriate for like Natives or Navajos. I had gone to this trading post when I was home at one point, and I found this really delicate silk that's like see-through. It's really beautiful, but like grandmas wear it like over their heads when they sheep herd. So I was like, oh, okay, yeah, like that makes sense. Like if I was a sheep herder, like looking for some action, like this would be my outfit. So yeah, so there was like the whole, this is my like, this is, some of the work that I do is also about creating like indigenous queer representation, just cause there's like a little bit of a lack of it. So this was my way to sort of like delve into creating like indigenous queer representation. And one way to like bring that in is also with the chain signifier as a way to like, you know, speak about like subversion and dominance and ownership, property. But so over you can't really see it in this photograph, but like there's some text that just repeats itself like over and over again in front of my chest. And that is basically just the word or the letters indigenous queer, so it's IND, but it's all through the Code Talker dictionary. So the Code Talkers, again, like, is like such a huge part of my, like my grandfather being a Code Talker, it was just such a huge part of our own like family ancestral like narrative. So the Code Talker dictionary really just it was during World War II, and it was just a way for the U.S. Army to like use indigenous languages as a way to create a code and get, so you know, the enemy wouldn't be able to decipher it. They chose Navajo Nation because it was so far removed from any other tribe in that region. And at the time that this happened, like there were hardly, barely any like fluent speakers who lived outside of the reservation. So when my grandfather comes back, like, you know, he's out of like harmony with like the Diné way. You know, the Diné way is like the beauty way. It's like this, the corn pollen path. It's like, it's all about balance and being at one with like the world and your community. And so he didn't, because he was like removed from the tribe, like, you know, at the drop of a dime, essentially, he wasn't really like given proper ceremony for like a going off to battle. So, you know, that entire like life cycle is like completely like altered and disrupted. And you know, when he comes back, he like develops like, you know, a strong addiction to alcohol and poverty, and it, you know, it's just a really sad fucked up story, because like these co-talkers come back from the war and they can't say shit about it. Like, they can't say anything about it because it's like still a top secret. It isn't until like the 80s and the 90s that like they actually get recognition from like mainstream America. But by that point, like, you know, Americans who are outside of the reservation have already made their minds up about what they consider a Native person to be. So I'm kind of referencing that within that word, like the poetics of the Code Talker dictionary. And there's also some text that goes around the image that says tradition is not the enemy of progress, evolution is not the enemy of tradition. So I'm using tradition is not the enemy of progress in direct reference to this book titled Navajo Means People, which is put out, I believe, by Duke University Press, like maybe in the 60s or something like that. But it's this like very anthropological gaze of a day in the life of the Navajo. So they have like the Navajos like down at the trading posts, like doing business. You have them like being disciplined by like white nuns, being washed and whatnot. You have them going with their kids. And then you have them like in a jail cell, like after the war, like, you know, this mother has to come down to the jail and like talk to the police and, you know, try to get like the record. It's a really weird book, but in that book, I saw this image that was taken outside of this church. So as you would leave this church, you'd see the sign that said tradition is in progress. And so this is, I wanted to sort of like flip it a little bit and just remind indigenous like communities, like, you know, to create like communities. But also within the reservation, like, there was like this really weird conservatism and assimilationist mindset about what is traditional that I feel like is tied to like colonization and forced assimilation too. I feel like sometimes it's a little outdated and doesn't really. Like, I feel like these are like a lot more empowered than they were, like, say, when my mother was a child. So I wonder how that would change. And I'm also I'm curious about how indigenous traditions or creation stories like evolve forward from, like, you know, just staying in this like stagnant past of like, oh, well, we don't do that because we're traditional. Like, that's a traditional teaching. I think sometimes that's like it's like following this like self-colonization or like assimilationist mindset that like gives more power to like the oppressor than like, to our own communities and ourselves. So that's one of those efforts. And then, this is one of the pieces I have in the exhibition. This is the other woman, Kaylee Spitzer, who has some pieces. She has like these really beautiful, really large tintype photographs of different women who are like both of Native or non-Native descent. They're really beautiful though, and you should really check them out. About her work, she doesn't like when people photograph it and show it again. So I don't have those images on hand. But this is us at the opening weekend. And that's a flag woven by this woman, Bertha Harvey. And that was woven in 1991. And it's just an image of the American flag. And the Portland Art Museum had it on view for like 8 years. And they really didn't want, like when I was talking with them about doing this exhibition, like this is one thing that just stuck out to me, like just always seeing it on the wall in the Native art section. But I really wanted to like turn it upside down and just like fuck with like these older ghosts. We got like this really outdated history of indigenous culture. But also anyone who has like this like really outdated perspective of indigenous people or art, like who go to the Portland Art Museum, like the Portland Art Museum as well. Like in some ways it's also like a fuck you to the Portland Museum. Anyway, there's this flag that she wove in 1991 and it's on display there right now. And they had to like darken that space a little bit more. So the piece could be on display. Again. And I also chose this piece because I was really interested in this poem by this Navajo poet Lucy Tapahanso, where she talks about the American flag. And so she's having this conversation with somebody in this poem, and they're talking about like they're having this conversation that's like pro-flag, anti-flag, and someone's like, I will never, like, you know, wear the American flag. I will never, like, have it in my household. Like, how could you do that? And the other woman's response is like, well, like, during the Long Walk, like, this American flag was, like, you know, we like, kept our traditions alive. Like, we kept moving. And one way for us to, like, find any strength and, like, the entire situation we've been in, or that we were in, was like to recontextualize the American flag, like to add new meaning to it. So like the white becomes symbolic, or sorry, the red becomes symbolic of like the dirt on the reservation. And I thought that was really beautiful. So it was, I know that that's like not like, I know that's not like completely evident in showing it. The name of the piece is called Resist White Supremacist Heteropatriarchal Colonization, which is referencing like bell hooks. But I thought it was important to like at least acknowledge the fact that like on reservation, like there's still like this like weird like patriotism that happens. And so this is another piece I have in the exhibition. I took this picture when I was in Powell's one day. I was in the Native art section or the Native studies section at Powell's. And so I just have all these books on top of my head. That I just picked up that I felt like some were books that I had read and some are like just books that I was curious about. On the very top is a book called The Navajo. I don't think it's probably not a book, like it's probably like a very anthropological book on the Navajo. It's probably not like our own telling of who we are as a people. It's followed by this book, Pocahontas, by Paula Gunn Allen, who like gives this really in-depth conversation about who this Pocahontas person is. That's like not really like the romanticized Disney version of Pocahontas. Like it talks about her, you know, marrying like
think his name's Kokomo in the Disney version. I think his name is in the book, or in real life, but like marrying him at a young age, getting pregnant by the time she's like 15. And then like, you know, she like basically was like dead by the time she's 21. But also like within like the whole Pokemon of the story, like it's also a one of like the first documented cases of like sex slavery in the States, like arguably. And that book is followed by Sherman Alexie's The Tonto and The Lone Ranger Fist Fight in Heaven, which is a really good book. And it delves a little bit into like this like creation story aspect and indigenous futurisms. And then that's followed by Ward Churchill's Fantasies of a Master Race. And I've never read that book, so I don't know what that's about. But it's Ward Churchill, so I felt like I should include it. And he just has a lot of like controversy about his like indigenous heritage. After 9/11, he made some really like weird comments that people weren't down with about 9/11. He got fired from his position in Colorado. The next book is this book by Ishii, or about Ishii, which is like the last of his race, but it's all from this like anthropological perspective. Theodore and, I think his name is Theodore, and whatever, his like wife, Kroger. And so they like take him in, and you know, Ishii's like celebrated in this region, like almost like on a celebrity level. He's like given the option to like return to his homelands, which have been like, you know, desecrated, and everyone who's tried is like dead. He doesn't, you know, he's the last person who speaks his language. He decides to stay in the house that he's living in at the time, which is like basically this anthropological research center. So that's a really fucked up narrative about a Native person. I flunked the course on like anthropology, but what I got out of the course was like that story, which was really like impactful. And I believe when he died, like they like kept his brain, like so the time science thought that they could still like extract knowledge from people's brains. I thought it was really curious that like they kept people like, I don't know, Einstein's brain, you know. I just imagine like what it would look like Einstein, Ishii, Edison or something, I don't know. And below that is this book by Muskogee poet Joy Harjo called In Mad Love and War. Yellow Dirt, which is about uranium mining and toxic radiation on the Navajo Reservation. It was like the community I grew up in, Gallup, is not far from where like the biggest uranium spill had happened in the United States. It's actually like the biggest like environmental disaster to happen in the United States, but it doesn't get talked about because it's like it affects indigenous people. So growing up like not far from there, but you know, there's a lot of birth defects, a lot of like health concerns that the community like has to face on a consistent basis. And then below that is a book by Roxanne Dunbar Ortiz called An Indigenous People's History of the United States. So I wanted to like do a larger version of that. I was hoping to like actually have like a part of my ancestry is Zuni, like around the time of the Long Walk. I mean, it's kind of fucked up, but like around the time of the Long Walk, my grandmother, was a Zuni woman, was like taken by my great-great-great-grandfather, and he would like only let her go back to the Zuni reservation like around the time of the Shalako, which is like this huge winter, it's not a festival, but like ceremony that happens like on the Zuni reservation. And then just, you know, just one winter, she just never comes back. But within like the Zuni tribe, there's like these Ola maidens who like they balance like pottery on top of their head. And they like, you know, I would see them a lot of the times at the intertribal ceremonial parades, like in downtown Gallup. There'd just be like a row of them, like one down. So I was kind of, I really wanted to reference that and like try to find a way to like carve these books into the shape of like some pottery, indicating that I was like balancing all that knowledge on my head or as I moved through the world. That's just, it's a lot more work than I had anticipated. So for the case of the show, I decided to do this really large, wide, like 15 foot high photo mural called Untitled Radical Indigenous Queer Feminist Bibliography. So my whole aim with this was to like honor a lot of the work that other scholars have done in the fields as ways to create like a basis or bibliography or the framework of what could be deemed radical queer feminism. So if one were to read all these books, like they could engage in a conversation about what radical indigenous queer feminism is. And so some of these books are like, some of these books are ridiculous. Like the Navajo means people. There's like a pictorial history of a Native American book that's in there. Some of them are just like stereotypical to a certain degree, but they've helped, like, I believe that they've like helped shape the way indigenous identity is like constructed or reclaimed. And then there's just other books that I feel like both communities could like benefit from. So something like Red Power Rising, which is about like the Native Youth Council and like how they've had like a profound impact like during, you know, around the same time as the formation of the Indian Small Tribes and the American Indian Movement. But then there's also a book by Audre Lorde Dani, which is a biomythography about her work or about her life. Black lesbian like in the 50s. But how she calls like this autobiography more like a biomythography, like, you know, tracing it back to like our own personal myths or creation stories. So yeah, and there's like some poetry mixed in there. Anyway, and so I have this other piece and it's not always on view. It's this like old school chrome projector that has like 69 slides, colored slides that complete this poem called American Bondage West. And so these images are all, they've all been like, they all come from like my cell phone. So it's like referencing a little bit of like technology, but they've all been digitized and are now like 35 millimeter slides at the Portland Art Museum. And it's just a poem that's about like landscape representation, decolonization to a certain degree, and this idea of like the American continent like being under bondage essentially, and every 7 seconds, which is like the same as like you breathing in and out, like the projector advances forward to the next slide. So these are some of the slides. And so this one on the far top right, the labor of colonization, is like after I cut my hair, after it had grown out a little bit, I feel like that, you know, that's something that I struggle with constantly, like, there's this blog called Indian Country Media Network, something, I forget what it's called, but they basically did this article not so long ago that was like, the top 10 reasons why hair is like so important for Navajo men or something like that. I don't know. It was kind of like clickbait to a certain degree, but it was about giving like more context to like the role and relationship indigenous people have to their hair, especially for men, but how it's been used as a tool of assimilation. So that's something that I you know, definitely come into conflict with a lot of the times, but I also think it's important to like be in control of your identity or how you want to like present yourself to the world. So there's that slide that's in there that's like a label of assimilation, which is just like this dude in bondage, like the sexualization of Native people or just people in general, or even of like the queer community, the binding of a continent. And then this last image is, it says the memory of forgetting. And I took this photograph at my grandparents' house. My grandfather has dementia. So every single time I go back, like he has just like forgotten a little bit more of who he is or even of who I am. Like I'm named after like my father who's named after him. So like technically I'm the third. So I went back one time and he didn't really know who I was and had to remind him about that whole narrative. But this, it's just a sheet that hangs between like the kitchen, the dining room, and like the living room. I just thought it was a really like sweet sentiment, like just a very soft moment in that household. And then these are two other pieces that I have in there. I mentioned before when we started that that photograph of my grandparents had gone. This dirt on the right side was taken like probably a 100 feet away from the Hogan. And so when I went back to the reservation, and this part is partially performative, like the way that land works on the res is you don't own the land, like it's all allotted to your family, and then you just have to like renew it after a certain amount of time. So my grandparents had both passed away, and my grandfather Terry, or my uncle Terry, like, you know, basically like spent his like 40s, like just sacrificed everything and, you know, moved in with them and took care of them. And so now he has like, now he's in control of their land and the house and the Hogan and all the sheep. But like that land itself, like it has like a ton of like ceremony, like just inside of the soil, not far from where this was dug out. Like all my sisters had like had made their quinoa cake, and so when a Navajo woman like goes through puberty, like she has this like 4-day ceremony of this quinoa, and on the last day, they build this like giant cake in the earth, and so. When we took the dirt out, like I remembered it, like so many of my sisters and like my nieces have like taken, like have just like had their ceremony in that space. So you know, a part of this is about honoring that, like the sacredness of Indigenous land, but also like the removal of it, and my like relocation outside of it. It's also honoring like. Nomadic and like migratory narratives that Indigenous people have. And, but within the reservation, like, you know, this like assimilationist thing that I'm talking about, like, there's this whole urban Indian, non-urban Indian thing. And so it feels like sometimes when I go back and I don't speak my language and I don't necessarily like immediately identify as being Navajo, that like I get criticized for being an urban Indian. But I feel like, you know, reservations were obviously like constructed as a way to like keep Indigenous peoples like in prison, like they also function as like prisons. So like, I'm also interested in like moving outside of that mindset or that framework and thinking that like, well, you know, it, like initially, like, yeah, we did see like benefits from like Western culture. So how can like these two cultures like come together. Anyway, so I brought all this dirt up. It's now at the Portland Art Museum. And once I'm done with it, I will drive it back and like take it back to the land. Because like with Indigenous ceremony, that's also a way to like to say that like I'm like committed or dedicated to like the culture, my people, my family. in that whole entire performance. But because of the ceremony as well, like, ceremony isn't just something that, like, happens, like, you know, for those 4 days. It's something that's, like, ongoing. You know, so I feel like by removing the land completely from its, like, indigenous, like, position, like, you disrupt the ceremony. But I really wanted to put, the dirt, like, underneath the flag, and then also underneath these, this, like, warrior shield and the ceremonial basket as a way to, like, create cohesion and, like, just a moment, like, a breath of, like, familiarity of, like, where, how these objects, like, live outside of the reservation and how they don't have, like, ties to, like, their ancestry. But the Portland Art Museum would not have it, so. which I get, like, they probably. But so there's this other piece in there, which is about coal. And so within the Navajo Nation, like, there's a shit ton of coal extraction. I remember as a youth, like, that's just how it was the cheapest way for us to, like, heat our house. Like, my father would wake us up on the weekends, or just randomly, I guess, during the week. And we would drive to, like, the coal mine, wait in a long line, and then by the 10 o'clock go in and, like, just fill the entire bed of the truck with coal. And you'd see, like, grandmas out there with, like, this is, like, a grandma shawl that's from the reservation, but they would have, like, their shawls, like, tied around their head, and then they'd be, like, dumping a shit ton of coal in the back of, like, a pickup truck. But, you know, no one in this region is sort of, like, told, like, how horrible coal is for the environment, but it's also, like, desecrating and affecting indigenous communities. Coal is used in this region to, like, power plants and like factories and shit. And so all that coal, like, ends up, like, polluting the reservation and causing, like, health effects. So these two pieces are about, like, land and extraction. And I just bought this from some dude, like, I bought, like, 2 bags from him for, like, $10. And I thought that was really, really cheap. Like the value of Earth and kind of fossil fuels. It's really, really gross. This next piece is called Tools for Resistance, Indigenous Resistance, and it's about ceremony. When I was in the art museum, I came across this Navajo basket. It's a traditional wedding basket. When I was a kid, my mother would always put, like, really sacred items inside of it, and we just kept it in the closet. But where there's that, like, opening, that, like, bridge that, like, comes out, where, like, that's supposed to always be, like, set to the rising sun. This is my way to sort of, like, revive that, because the Portland Art Museum didn't really know that that's the way it's, like, traditionally supposed to be positioned. And then there's, like, just this, like, Navajo warrior shield from, like, back in the day. I was really interested in creating this sort of, like, relationship and this, like, symbol. And some of my work references was inspired by, like, Felix Gonzalez Torres and how he uses those images. So it was just, like, indigenizing that image. So I guess that's it. But an image I made, it's a GIF that says, "Where are the endless resources to abolish colonization?" I was watching this, like, 1960s documentary series on Netflix. They have, like, the 60s and 70s and 80s, and you can watch them on Netflix. So I started watching the 60s, and it's all about, like, JFK. And they're just talking about, like, trying, like, it's really interesting and fascinating because they're, like, really trying to, like, dissect that time period and how paranoid people were and, like, what theories people had versus, like, what they have today. And so for this piece, they mentioned at one point, like, oh, well, there were just, like, endless resources for, like, figuring out, like, who assassinated the president. And And I just thought, like, well, where are the endless resources to, like, abolish colonization? Like, why are we wasting our time? Let's get to, like, the meat of your argument and, like, dismantle colonization. Anyway, that's it. Are you going to take questions?
Yeah, if anyone has questions. Yes. So going off of this, I'm interested in this idea of, like, when you don't have resources, you know, whether it's a dearth or just a complete lack. And I see this in your work as a level of, like, reclamation of frameworks. So, you know, reclamation of things like No Way, which is a white punk thing.
Right.
Reclamation of, like, I'm thinking specifically of this piece of yours where you take page 113 of The Wage by Virginia Woolf.
Oh, yeah.
And you lay it over a map to Albuquerque. So those kinds of reclamations are, like, you know, the big pile of books, some of which are written by several authors, like Gertrude Stein or some other examples like that. And I'm interested in hearing more about that, I guess.
Oh, about what exactly, though?
About,
I'm sorry,
when you have a lack of resources, how you kind of reclaim frameworks that are not indigenous and put them to use in advance of decolonizing land and mind.
Yeah.
If that's something that comes through your mind when you take those.
Not really. I mean, I think I just make random, yeah, I don't know. I think they just come up as, like, random connections that I make to.
Cool.
I think a part of it too is, like, Tumblr, like, really helped me figure out how, like, or made me curious in terms of, like, how certain images, like, get put together. And so, I mean, one image that inspired me to Gertrude Stein is, like, there's this picture that Felix Gonzalez-Torres took of Gertrude Stein and Alexander Torres's grave. And then I put it on top of this image of David Wonorowicz burying himself in dirt, like, after, or during, like, you know, the whole AIDS epidemic and shit. But I was really interested, like, there's, like, this weird sort of relationship, I think, that all those three people share. So I guess I'm interested in, like, how certain things are connected, or how certain people or concepts are connected. And so, like, with like, Virginia Woolf, that piece is talking about, like, what's underneath the city, you know? And so then I started to think about, like, how she, like, was a female writer during that time period. And, you know, she wrote a piece, she was, like, allowed to read this piece about, like, how important it is for women or female to, like, have the room to, like, create work. But, you know, she was also, like, like, she also handset, like, all her titles, and so there's something really beautiful about that process, too, like, feeling, like, the physical weight of the word as you're, like, writing it. And printing it, like, all the labor that's involved, but really, like respecting and honoring, like, the fact that, like, she did this during that time period. And so that was a way for, when I did that piece, I was thinking a lot about, like, the weight of somebody else's words and how they, like, impact you. And that's only one page, you know.
It was about, like, directionlessness, like, sort of wandering, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's awesome. Thank you.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, I feel like at this time period that I'm doing some of this shit, like, right, like, I have access to PNCA, like, I have access to a studio, I have access to places, but it costs us just money, not that I can afford to ever pay it back, but, like, I don't know. I don't know what it would be like if I were on the reservation making artwork and, like, what resources would be available to me. Like, that's a different conversation. That's just a different situation that I'm not, like, I'm, like, privileged to be in a situation that I'm in now. So, yeah.
Thank you.
The internet is, like, a really huge, like, inspiration to the work. A lot of my videos, like, or some of the videos that I've made, like, just pulled directly from the internet. But those images, like the No Way Feminism poster, like, those all came from Google searches. And I just, like,
bumped up the quality as much as I could.
Did you change your hobby for you just don't want to do it?
Dude, yeah, it's like a site called Keepit, where you can like download shit. But like that was a happy accident. Like I redid that video. Like I spent like a week like just memorizing it from like the screen, so my body would move the same direction as the screen. And so then when it gets re-recorded, it gets mirrored. Yeah, yeah. Like that was really that was weird. Yeah.
Who else? Yeah.
I don't know when you grew up, but I did grow up in the 70s and 80s. Pop culture was a huge influence to me as being someone from multicultural, marginalized backgrounds. And I majored in photo, but I almost majored in graphic design because I actually saw letters at shapes. And I noticed throughout the work, after you said the first thing you wanted to do was to mimic the DNA of Felix patterns, is that in multiple pieces, I saw that, even if you weren't trying to do that, I thought that was pretty cool. I was wondering how much you were influenced by both science and science fiction.
Oh.
Sorry.
No, it's good. I think, well, there's this idea of, well, you know, there's this emerging genre of like indigenous futurisms. And so, I don't know. I feel like creation stories is sort of a, in some ways, like a sci-fi narrative of indigenous people. So I feel like growing up on the reservation, we would like drive like to and from like our grandparents' house, or growing up outside of the reservation. So I always felt like there was this like going back to the past and then like going back into the future. And then some of that is coupled with like hearing these creation stories, which are like sometimes just like so out of left field almost, you know, like that poem that I just wrote, like that I read at the beginning about emerging from an equilibrium world, like within the Navajo, within our creation story, like we're presently like in the glittering world, like we climb through like this rod, like hollowed out by woodpecker, and so that now we're like in this like glittering wonderful world where like there's like color, versus like other worlds where there was just like locust swarms and darkness. So I feel like, you know, in those terms, like it definitely has like this sci-fi influence. But I don't think I was necessarily like influenced by like sci-fi film.
Yeah. I just love the concept of it, of
right.
Realizing the past and the future and the present are all different things. Being
like, yeah.
You kind of traverse all of them as an artist sometimes.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean that I think this like indigenous futurisms thing is like a really good genre because it allows us to like put those narratives into like a different sort of mindset or framework. Anyway, yeah.
Question about the indigenous futurism.
Okay.
Those photographs that you said you got from Google Images, and then you also said some of them were probably taken by an Anglo photographer. I guess I'm thinking back about like, I immigrated here from Thailand, and then like just trying to understand what Thailand is in the context of the U.S. and why, like before colonization, and what it was called before Thailand, and the dress code that was and then going on Google and finding those vintage images of people that, look different, didn't have to cover up, and, you know, and all those things. And it made me uneasy to, like, find those images because I know that they were, like, from, like, a Natural Geographic magazine. But sometimes I was so relieved to find images of my people before. And so I was wondering, like, I always echo with, like, if I were to take back those things that I see in images, like appropriating my own culture, like what, like, you know, so those are the things I'm thinking of. So do you have any comments on that?
Yeah, no, that's hard. I felt really weird doing that with like the Navajo feminism, especially because like within like Navajo culture, like there's like all this superstition when it comes to death, like respecting death and the dead. And so I was wondering what I was what it meant for me to be taking somebody else's image and like using it like in my own artwork. But I felt like it was important to like, I felt like it was important to like reclaim it through this conversation that has like the potential to like have a positive impact for like Indigenous communities. And it was a way for me to honor, she kind of looks like that woman, the No Way Feminism woman, like she kind of looks like my cousin. I sometimes wonder if like that was the connection that I immediately like was drawn to. Her mother went in like back in like 2001, 2002, something like that. And so like that's always been like in our family. Like the fact that our aunt's gone, like, you know, is she still alive or not, you know? But like this is like a huge problem like in that region in general, like Native women who like go insane or die. And so I don't know, I think that like around the time that I made that image, like I was like trying to figure out ways that I could like work with that inside of my work. But yeah, I don't know. It's like, it's really tricky territory. I recently made this poster about this girl who went missing, who was abducted by like one of her own relatives, some Native person in their own community. And then she was murdered. And so I made that poster and it was after the fact that like, you know, all this came to light and she's a Navajo girl. It's a Navajo family. And I spent like 4 hours like making this image and it felt really weird like during the whole process because I didn't feel like there was enough. I don't know, I didn't use her name in the image, like within the Navajo stories as well. Like once someone passes, like you're not supposed to say their name for a while, so you allow their spirit to like go on to the next world. But like that still feels weird, but I think, you know, some of these posters of like just Indigenous peoples like being on the internet, having them be consumed in like in ways that like non-Native communities are like deciphering, or even in Native communities where that they're interpreting them, like I think it's more important to like reclaim them and add different context to it. So it's not just like the be all end all, you know, like so I don't know. I mean, I hope that the images aren't negatively affecting anyone, but like, that's a really weird place to make work from. But like, I just think it needs to get made. Yeah. Anyway,
I'm interested in maybe a similar question, but how you decide what images or what content to use when it's not Indigenous, but adjacent in the context of queerness. You mentioned Marsha P. Johnson, and in the context of transness, how do you decide to bring that into the conversation, or what obligation then you feel like the work has to have the positive impact?
Well, that image was really, like I had just watched this documentary on Marsha P. Johnson called K at No Mind. And then I also came across another documentary or just some video footage of like Sylvia Rivera. And there's some footage of her like at this rally, just screaming at like this group of like white gays, mm-hmm. just basically saying like, I've given my entire life to like the gay rights movement. And like,
even and they're like booing her shit. Talking.
They're booing her, actually.
They're booing her, yeah. They're like, they do not want her up there. And they're all like, it's like very like mob mentality almost. Like, and so, you know, by the end of it, like, she like somehow convinces, or she convinces them, like, she has to convince them that, like, you know, they should be on the same page. Like, they should actually be fighting because, like, a shit ton of people in the trans community have, like, given their lives, like, whether they meant to or not, like, whether it was their choice or not, like, for the gay rights movement, but just also, like, for themselves. And so, I don't know, I was, like, always, like, sort of just inspired, but also empowered by, like, that, by that mindset, but also just wanting to, like, show like my respect for that history and for those lives. Like growing up, I, you know, like the story I got fed was like Matthew Shepard. Like, oh, you know, all like you hit on the wrong guy at a bar or anywhere and you're gonna like end up on a fence, like, you know, bleeding to death. So like I don't know, I didn't want to like focus on that imagery. I felt like I feel like these really empowering images that like get documented are a part of like the queer canon, like oftentimes like there's more of a story that, you know, that is a part of like a more like collective like story. And so I'm interested in like creating a in like choosing that image with like the two gender gradient people in that photograph, like it's more of a question, I think, that I'm interested in like asking the people like through the image. It's like, what's the connection here? And like, these are both like really strong like political messages, and like, how do we like, in putting these two images together, like what type of framework like is possible? Like, how do we move forward as a community? I don't know. I guess it just depends on like who's in the image. Like, it's like on personal, like the history of that image, and how it has ties to whatever community that I'm a part of. Yeah. Does that make sense? Or
yeah.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah, it does. It's like an unanswerable question, but I also just wonder like what obligations we put on ourselves around the images we make to do the good that we want to do on them. But we get that it comes from a place of if you're trying to honor something, honor this certain history.
Right. Yeah. Well, and there's a lot of history that like isn't like readily available to like mainstream public. You know, so in showing that image, like it has the potential to reach like a wider audience. Like I put that image on Facebook and it got reblogged like a shit ton. And so then I'm curious like how because it's like a large Native community. So then I'm interested in how the Native community like responds to it. There's a lot of like like really conservative and like backwards politics on the reservation. My hope is like, you know, a young like queer or trans kid sees that and doesn't like kill themselves, or you know, like sees that like it is possible within like their own culture, like there is a history of like gender gradient or multi-sexual like sexualities like in their own culture, you know. But yeah, so I guess I'm also just interested in like, yeah, the Western and the Indigenous narratives and how that gets like interpreted like to the viewer.
I feel like I don't know if this is like a question or a statement, but I feel like in seeing your work and like you talk about this and like the points at which like you are interacting with like what is seemingly like more of a social practice side of things that is like extremely intersectional, and it's centered around indigeneity, but it's also welcoming other like identities that are within your like own personhood and like most not most, but like I feel like I'm wording this really improperly right now, but like at least like most of the people like I know and like I understand we know like come from these intersectional backgrounds. And so that's kind of like given with the like radicalized like and like sovereign idea of indigeneity, and that's centered around like your experience and your ancestry. But I feel like when you are like looking at these things intersectionally, you're also pulling from other like female authors of color who are like feminists, who are not like from an indigenous side. You're like pulling the frameworks into that. Is that kind of where you're coming from with like everything that you're doing, not in like a sense of like homogenizing and like refuting experience, but like more so like, hey, these are like commonalities here, and like creating like a network within those commonalities, and like that is like what survivance means to you. Is that kind of like the gist of that? If
yeah.
Like I've kind of heard this, but not actually like that. You know?
Yeah. No, I think it is. Like that's, well, a lot of my work is just referencing, like a lot of my work just references other people's work. Like at the very like base level of it to a certain degree, like it's just like creating connections between like, I don't know, Gertrude Stein and Marsha P. Johnson or something, you know, like trying to like find some sort of connection or similarities that we all share, but it's all, you know, responding to like white supremacy and heteropatriarchy as ways to like dismantle it. Whether that's like dismantling like how like misogynist like queers can be or like native communities can be, like it's kind of like putting everyone, like calling everyone out. I mean, I feel like even with some of the images, like, and or some of the intersections that, sorry, I feel like some of the intersections that I have with some Native artists who are very like well and like informed with like feminism or queerness to like their own degree, like they still like have these like hyper masculine perspectives. So I'm interested in like how. I'm like someone interested in like calling that out to a certain degree. Like, how do we dismantle patriarchy within our work? Like that should be like that should be a top priority for like an indigenous straight man. I feel like I'm going a little bit off topic, but like it's I feel like it's all sort of like reaching like toward the same goal. So my work is compiling like a bunch of different people's work as a way to create, yeah, to create this cohesion, to create like this like shared sort of relationship and like, you know, potential for like an end goal that isn't centered around like this anglicized like Western narrative.
And there's something that like through like doing like my own work, like looking at different like resources available for like queer and trans indigenous people, specifically like within Portland where there's like a Facebook group.
Mm-hmm.
And it's basically looking at like compiling those resources and like colonization as like a means of like the canon of colonization being a recorded history that is often not from like the people who actually experienced that, and like is your work when you are like using these images that like may also be canonized, but also like maybe like images of like the like female form as viewed through like this very like heteropatriarchal lens, like are you beyond like the protest poster art original thing, looking to archive that differently? And like, are you doing any writing around that?
No.
Chill.
I'm not doing any writing around it. I mean, like.
But you're doing artist talks.
Yeah, I've written like a little bit here and there, but like, yeah, I feel like that's the next route to go toward as well. Like talking about like no wave feminism or indigenous feminism to a certain degree, and I guess that's where like this whole like I had a hard time with it at first. Like I just saw like the importance of having the images and just reacted to it. So like sometimes whenever I create something, it's just like an immediate reaction. I did this video about like some like gay bashing that happened in Portland, and Pepper like wrote this response on their Facebook page about like how to keep safe in sort of like in certain situations, and especially that involved alcohol, and how do you like celebrate to liberate like queerness during like this whole like it was during Gay Pride like a few years ago. So I just made an immediate video like off of like that. It's like really shitty. It's like a movie. It has like all these like really horrible like fade-ins and transfers and shit, you know? It'll look really good in like 10 years. right now it just looks like, oh yeah, you're like a first semester college student, you know? But like it was the only thing I could do, you know. It was like an immediate response, and all it is just like some of the text that is overlaid, or some of the text that Pepper said, some like a spray canister, you know, to like shoot in someone's eye, mace, right? And like, you know, just signs of like public or just defending yourself, like self-defense. And then at the end of it, it's just like referencing like all these different books, right? Like it brings in like Audre Lorde's Zami or Gender Trouble by Judith Butler, but it puts it alongside like, I don't know, a picture of like Beth Ditto or Dorothy Allison, or like Craigslist connections, the Anarchist Library or shit. You know, it's just like, it's about creating this like framework that, you know, is hell-bent on like safety and awareness, but also like personal empowerment. So yeah, getting back to like the No Way Feminism posters or some of these like other posters that I have, like it's more about like something just snaps and I just make it immediately. Like I kind of recognize the connections, I know like what's going on, I just haven't completely dissected it like through word. But you know, it's also like really interesting. Like I'm also really invested and interested in like creating this subgenre as like radical indigenous queer feminism, because I feel like other people are already creating similar work. It just gets like pushed aside into like these like different subsections. And so I think in advancing that forward, like there has to be more work on like, you know, that I make that, I think there's more work in whatever like projection that I'm handed down right now that like I have to make in order for me to like write about it and have that conversation. And so through poetry, I feel like I'm like getting there, like I'm finding like those connections to like this like queer feminist like mindset, like where that comes from, like how it has ties to my ancestors, like my own family's like history. Like the more that I hang around my mother, the more she tells me about like our family and my father, you know, and how my upbringing like impacts where I'm from. So I feel like through poetry, like that is all coming out. It's just it's not like neatly assembled right now. Like the main thing is like the image. And so, but I'm really interested in like how that framework happens. Like, is it like in the form of a book or what, you know?
Or is it in the form of like oral history?
Right, exactly. I feel like the easiest thing though is a book. Like I feel like creating, I think it's like it'd be interesting to like create curriculum around it. As much as like I like, you know, have, I feel like as much as I'm critical of like the institutions like higher ed and shit, like I also see like the benefit of them. And I think that comes through like curriculum mm-hmm. on and off of reservations about this stuff. Yeah.
In the beginning, you spoke a bit about the relationship to what that was like. And how is it working for the art museum? How do you find other similarities?
I don't know. I got asked to do that show with another artist, and I had just done like this podcast interview, and like she had asked me like how I work with institutions, and I was like, well, really the only ones I've worked with are like PNCA, and I did that show like for an art movie, and so when that whole like shortly after that like. The Portland Art Museum opportunity came up and I just went for it. Like, I was like, okay, this is an opportunity for me to like work in this like newly designed space. Because at that point, like the Center for Contemporary Native Art, like was just beginning to like open up. And so Sarah Seastrom, Greg Archibalda, and Greg Robinson like had some pieces in there. And they're more like that space is supposed to be used more for like contemporary emerging indigenous artists, and I think it's more specific to this region. And they're all from tribes that are from this region. And so Kaylee is, who I'm sharing the space with, like she's from a tribe in First Nations Canada, Kaskadena. And I'm from a tribe in the Southwest, but like I live up here. So I think that was like how I got into that whole thing. And it like initially, like I just agreed to do it and I didn't really think about it. And it wasn't until like I was like a month and a half out that I realized what I was doing. And I was like, oh shit, like I have an opportunity to like really use that, like my time in the Portland Art Museum to like see how it operates and like pull whatever strings that I can. And it was weird, like it was weird working with, like the special collections department a little bit. Like once they were finally on board, like I felt like they were like 100% behind it. But I feel like it's been really, my experience with them and the show that I've had at the Portland Art Museum, like they've been like very like generous with everything. Like they agreed to build, like they built like the vitrines for those pieces. They printed like the photo mural, like themselves. I don't know. It's actually been like, because of the project that I chose to do in that space, like it's actually been like, they've just been like really awesome to work with. I think that would be different if the project were different. Like I said, like I really wanted into the vitrines with some of the like ancestral tradition, like you know, old school like ceremonial basket they have there. They weren't down with that.
What was the reasoning?
That they wouldn't do it?
Yeah.
I think it's just they were worried that it would like potentially like damage the life of the basket or...
Yeah, but that seems like a very different idea of what the item is and preserving it means.
Right. I think they're just like...
They don't want it to get dirty.
That's yeah. What it is. Yeah, they don't want it to get dirty. Like, they don't want some random thing to happen. I mean, I just chose to like make that compromise because initially, I mean, that was like secondary. Initially, I just wanted it in there. And then I thought that it would be a really strong poetic piece to like have it with the actual objects. And then when that got shot down, I just went back to the vitrine idea. And yeah. But yeah, I don't know, they've been really, they've been easy to deal with and support, like everything. Yeah.
It's good.
Yeah. What was that?
It's the least they could do.
Yeah. they wouldn't show one video, actually. It was this video that ended. I have this video called The Nation of Slum. It's about cruising on the reservation.
That was the one with the hanky.
That was the one with the hanky, yeah. And there's like a little bit of dick in there.
Yeah.
And so they wouldn't show that. But I spoke with the curator, and she was like, I have this other video in there that's just of my ancestral line, and it references like the dirt that's in there. Like there's a poem by Joy Harjo called "Returning from the End." That is laid atop the footage, and it's just like the spoken word piece that I, like stream of consciousness piece that I did at my grandmother's land up when she was still alive. So just like the single shot of the horizon is like a red dog in the background. But I'm just talking about what it's like to like live outside of the reservation and come back to it, try to relate with like some of the like elderly folk in the region. So I had that piece, and I was going to show this indigenous love one of me like cruising. And that one is about like calling out like white queer spaces. But also about like, you know, trying to like instigate like sex positivity on the reservation. Like at one point it says like two spirits like giving each other blowjobs at the powwow or something like that. And there's another part that's like, what if there was ceremony for queer people who were like coming out like on the reservation? What if it was like an antiretroviral Sundance? And so antiretroviral therapy is like for people who are HIV positive. But it's like, what would it look like in the communities if there was like actual ceremony for someone who was positive or who had different like ailments? Because like sexuality and is like still taboo on a lot of reservations. But yeah, so they were like, no, we like, if you really want to show it, we'll show it. But I feel like that would take away from some of the other pieces that you have. And I was really worried because I was like, oh, is it just because I'm showing dick? Like, is it because there's like, yeah. Is it because there's like a penis in the video? Because I was like, because Kaylee's like showing like, this is before she like went into the whole conversation, but she was like, no. Because I got offended because I was like, because Kaylee's showing like breasts, and like, I don't think that's right. But she explained it some more. They didn't have any problems with the imagery. I think they were worried that like schools wouldn't go into that space because of some of the language that was inside of the video. So they were worried that like the work would be seen by like, by all the high schools that like come to the museum. Just because it says like fuck, right. Or yeah. I don't know. That was the other thing. That was really weird. Like hard to deal with. But that was like maybe a week or two out. The exhibition.
That was right before it opened.
Yeah. That was, well, because we decided to put the video inside of the exhibition, like, kind of at the last minute. And I proposed, like, the video that's in there now and that Indigenous Love video. And so it was a really quick thing that had to go, like, get decided. And, yeah, that sucked.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. I guess I get it, but like, what if high schoolers not seeing this in the video, you know, it's not as if, like, they're playing GTA 5 and shit, like.
They have Snapchat.
Yeah. It's like patronizing, you know?
Yeah. It is. That was, that, yeah. That's like the, that like didn't sit well with me for a few days.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, you're welcome. I felt weird too because I had considered like, okay, well, if they're not going to show that, then they're just not going to show work. But I felt like that wasn't an appropriate response because I had been working so hard with like Haley to like set up that space.
Yeah.
And
I drove all the way to get the dirt.
I drove all the way to get the dirt. Well, I also just really, I recognize the importance of having that space in general. Like before that, it was just like a learning center with like a bunch of books and like kids inside of it. And so I recognize the importance of the fact that like, you know, Dina Dart was like doing her best to like bring that space into the position that needs to be in, like creating that space for like emerging artists on like a floor that has like, you know, like all of our like old,
it's all history.
Yeah.
There's one tiny room for the present and the rest of the history.
Yeah. Anyways, anyone else have questions?
Wait. Really quick question. How are the Google image stats of the original image versus your poster? You've been in progress.
Oh, I don't know. Yeah, because I mean, well, so then the other thing about Tumblr and like, yeah, the other thing about Tumblr that I really like is the fact that you can tag shit. And so I think that becomes like a really like awesome tool. Like if you're like strategic about it, like I don't know, it you can like type in like the right chord combo and it comes up at the right time, you know. So that, I mean, in terms of like text, like image, like Google searches. Oh, you know, the image. Like I tried the Google image search for that No Way Feminism,
yeah.
And it's just a bunch of people who. But like, I couldn't actually find the image that it was tied to through Google.
Yeah, that's kind of what I meant. So it's,
yeah,
it's the dominant image in Google now instead of.
Yeah, and I think for some of them, like it's a little bit different. Yeah, Google image search is crazy. It's on the phone sometimes. But yeah, being strategic, like with the tag option, like that's a lot of fun. Because you can like really mess with the way Google like sometimes. Thank you. Anyone else? Thank you guys so much.
Thank you.